Good day to all of you. There was a time in this FB Live programs when I used to start off with good afternoon, but then I realized that we have viewers from all over the world. So for some people it is good morning, for some people it is good afternoon, some people it is good evening. So now we shall stick to good day and also happy day, as many people want to say it. Yes, but happiness and exams don't seem to be covering with each other. Even though exams are a stepping stone towards moving for a better quality of life, somehow our system has been such that exams seem to be causing too much tension, at least to some children. There are children who just breeze through it, they're least bothered. But those are the children who cause stress to their parents. When the parents feel that, my child is not studying, exams are there and still the child is hanging around, wasting time and all. So the parents get stressed out. Then there are a lot of children who get stressed out. It is not the children who are getting less marks or not scoring well who are stressed out or who need more of support, surprisingly. Even if you see something as drastic as children who commit suicide after the exam result comes, you'll find that while lakhs of students fail in the board exam, very few out of those commit suicide. The people who commit suicide are those who have passed the exam but have not got enough marks as per somebody's, you know, expectations. And who is that somebody? It could be the child himself, it could be the teachers, or it could be the parents. If the child feels that the parents have certain expectations which are not able to fulfill, that creates a lot of tension, a lot of anxiety in the child. And the child says that what will happen if I don't get enough marks? As we know, there is so much talk about competition, which I personally do not believe in. When I was giving the IIT entrance exam, there were 5 IITs. Today we have 23 IITs, 40 NITs, another 30 or 40 IIITs, and another 100 reputed engineering colleges, top-notch engineering colleges. So if the number of children aspiring to become engineers has increased, the opportunities have also increased. And that's only one part of it. In those good old days, you had to be an engineer, doctor, lawyer, IAS officer or something in order to get a so-called rewarding career. Today, there are 100 careers in which children can, if they do well, if they have the passion and it is backed up with talent and aptitude, they can do extremely well. That's another thing which we seem to have forgotten. So we only talk about 10th standard child, you must get enough marks to get into plus two in a good school or a good college. And they have very high cutoffs. Now, what is this definition of good school and good college? Yes, I agree that there are some very, very reputed colleges, for example, PU colleges, where it would be a pleasure if your child gets in. But we forget that there are innumerable other colleges which have come up recently, but are doing extremely well. And if your child can get admission in one of those, you can do very, very well. This is what we seem to forget. We seem to be just chasing only those things. And this is, I am addressing the adults. Somehow the adults seem to be living in the past. In their good old days, if there were A, B, C, D top-notch colleges, they still think that only that A, B, C, D, E are available and my child should get in. And in those days, if there were 1,000 children aspiring to get into those top-notch colleges, today there are 10,000 students aspiring to get into those. And that is the reason why parents get very, very, you know, worked up and very, very tensed. And that tension passes down to the child. So today I thought, since exams are coming up, both annual exams as well as the board exams. Annual exams in many cases have already started, because that's another thing that we have seen happening. For example, a number of schools advance their 9th standard annual exam and finish off with it. And instead of giving a holiday to the children immediately after that, they start the 10th standard. Now this, I don't know what we are leading to. I had met an American professor who used to come regularly, you know, as an adjunct professor here. And one day I was asking him that, what do you think is the difference between the education system in USA and the education system in India? He said, I don't know about your Indian education system, but I do know that you have a fantastic examination system. Nobody talks education, they only talk examination. How sad, no? Is that all that matters? And funnily enough, after that, there is enough evidence to show that the toppers do not necessarily have better careers and better lives than those who get lesser marks. You have seen it. If you're an adult, if you go back to right from your, you know, school days or college days, and look around and see, you had these fantastic toppers who were all the time stuck in the books and will always get the first rank or fifth rank or whatever it is. Have they really got better careers and are they really doing better? No, it is a fact. I not only graduated from IIT Bombay, one of my classmates finished, he went for a few years into the corporate world, didn't like it, came back, did his M.Tech and then did his PhD and became a faculty. And he went on to be there for a very, very long time. At one time, he became the Dean of the Student Affairs. And he was telling me that when he looks at the people who have passed out with top-notch ranks and they got into the best of campus recruitment or the best of higher studies for management colleges or whatever it is, he says, since he monitors many of them, not many of them really achieved in life what they should have achieved, given the fact that they were the toppers. These are facts. These are open facts which are available to you. So can we, as concerned adults, being a teacher, being a counselor, being a parent, in any form, if you're a concerned adult, yes, do encourage the child to do well in the exams, but do not make exams the barometer of success of the child. Understand that top-notch marks do not necessarily get the best of everything to the child. It starts with the basic thing of not getting stressed out yourself. Somehow children can see and observe your body language. They can read between your comments and understand what you are saying. So start off with, de-stressing yourself, telling yourself that while I will encourage my child to do better and better, I will not create a scenario where I convey to the child that he has to do well, that the whole world is going to collapse if he does not do well. Let us not, do that. Secondly, instead of just like a broken record going on and on and on, telling the child, study, 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 why don't we help the child to understand how to study in that smart manner, as they say, no? Instead of studying hard, you study smart. Even from the examination point of view, even from the point of view of getting good marks, isn't it good that you should get, better marks by smart studying rather than studying hard? A child who has to study 16 hours a day burn the midnight oil, as they say, just to get those marks, is not really achieving anything. Can we not teach the child how to get better marks, you know, by studying smarter? And there are so many simple proven techniques. As the exam comes closer, let the child not study those topics which he has just not been able to grasp. If he has not been able to grasp it the whole year, it doesn't serve any purpose if we push it down his throat. A simple thing like not creating tension on the day of the exam. That is the night before the exam is the time when the child needs to have a good night's sleep. It makes a difference that he wakes up nice, rested and fresh so that he can face the exam. But there are so many children, because of the tension at home or because of expectations, that is the night where they say that I have to study. I have to go on studying. The morning of the exam also, what they do is they give up their basic need. They don't even have a proper breakfast. Isn't it better to have a good, healthy breakfast so that, you know, you're feeling not hungry, you're not tired, and then go for the exam? Even while going for the exam, I have seen parents lecturing to the child. You have to do well. Don't do this. Don't do that. You make sure you do this. That is the time to talk to the child about anything and everything other than exams. That is the time when you de-stress your child by talking. You're on the way. Talk about something that you see on the way. Talk about something which, you know, distracts the mind of the child, makes the child feel more comfortable and happy. And tell the child not to discuss any of the exam things at the last moment with his friends. Because inevitably some child, some classmate will say, have you prepared that fifth chapter? I'm told a lot of questions are going to come from that. Now, fifth chapter was the one which is weak for this kid. And suddenly his confidence level goes down. Tell the child that there are two things which are very, very, very useful. Forget about all those tonics and this and that which people try to sell to improve memory, to improve concentration. I haven't come across any of those which are actually useful. But I have come across two things which are very, very useful during the lineup for the exam and also on the day of the exam. And both of them are free. Air and water. Teach your child how to get more oxygen into his body. Slow and deep breathing. If oxygen goes into his body, his brain gets stimulated. The same thing with water. Exams are inevitably at a time when the summer is coming in and the heat is on. If the child can keep drinking water and keep himself hydrated, he will find that he is in a much better position to, you know, remember, concentrate, face the exams or whatever it is. And the same thing applies when the child comes out of the exam. Do not discuss anything about the exam paper till the last exam is over. The moment you start discussing and he realizes that he made a silly mistake here or he forgot a question there, again his confidence level goes down. Simple things, but if we can do all these things, you will realize that very average children also can do well in the exams. Give positive strokes to the child. Say that, okay, we are aiming for college A, but if you don't get, we also have B and C and D. Any one of them is good enough. Give that hope to the child. that you will do something. Talk about the future. Once you do this, you can go into this higher studies. Once you go into the higher studies, this is what you can do. Let the child understand that there is a bright future. Unfortunately, there are some parents who keep on saying, if you don't study, what will be your future? I can't afford to give donation and get you into a professional college. If you don't get into a professional college, what is going to happen to you? Instead of that, say, I am confident that we will get somewhere or the other. You put in your best effort. I will guide you. And then I will help you how to get admission in a good college. We'll make a list. You may not get in your choice number one, but there's always choice number two, choice number three. Okay. In order to, you know, help you to understand systematically how this process goes, I asked Anis to make a few slides for us, and Purni will now, you know, show you those slides and run you through that, and then I'll be back in a few minutes.
Okay, so the technology is challenging us with the exams, and Anis is trying her, you know, different ways to get it started. So I'll just take you through a few do's, don'ts, and, you know, some time-tested techniques which we have been able to successfully share it with a lot of students, because we have so many of them coming in, and quite a few of them come for the career thing also. Just before the exams, parents come with a lot of, you know, anxiety, and they're very anxious how things are going to take place. So I'll share with you a few things. One is that very clear, near exam time, don't try to change study habits. So if a child has kind of, you know, gotten used to a particular way of studying, possibly with some music or studies in the morning, or says, no, after bath I will start studying, or something like that, don't change it close to exam, because that can, you know, just immediately upset their routine. So generally not a good idea near exam, which we would also say around 2-3 weeks before the exam. Don't change their habits too much, because we need to remember at all points of time that marks do not indicate the potential of any candidate. So exams too are not a barometer of success for your child. That's just one of the means. There are innumerable different ways how we can get through the exams, not only of academics. I think I would like to step in a little further and say the exams of life also. So organized timing. Example, guests, entertainment, TV, grandparents, food. Let me just explain this. So let's assume that you ought to be getting some guests for a function or something like that. Sit down and also discuss it with your family members and with your child, saying that auntie and uncle are going to be coming at this time. He'll say, Mama, don't invite them for lunch. Call them for high tea or for dinner. So if a little bit of collaboration and cooperation happens, he is in a better space. The child studies well because he knows that he has the support of the parents. Also, at the same time, there are some times when you know that he is doing something which is a little pivotal. And if there is a major entertainment happening, there is a karaoke singing happening, or if everybody has, you know, pulled in at your place to be doing some kind of, what do you say, meeting up or something like that, that may distract the child. So it's a good idea that entertainments at such times don't come in. And of course, TV, because that can be a major distracting, especially if you have been watching some TV serials together. If and only if it is okay with you, if you think that by not watching that serial where the volume will go, you know, loud to him or something, then it's a good idea possibly not to watch it, or ensure that the volume is a little less. Otherwise, he'll be distracted. All his attention will be on what is happening in the, you know, hall room with his favorite program on. Yes, even small things like, you know, if grandparents are along, take their support to ensure that he can have better study timings, food habits, food timings, and small things actually go a very long way in ensuring that, you know, we can introspect for ourselves. Don't mix studies with extracurricular. He needs entertainment and exercise. Many a times it happens that, you know, we end up telling, are you studying? Are you studying? Mama, can I go and play some cricket? No. You have time to play cricket. You don't have time to study. So all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. So we don't want dull boys and girls. So ensure that the extracurricular activities also happen, but speak to them in advance. You say that, yes, you do need some fresh air. So instead of playing some major, action games or something like that, go for a nice walk, go for a light jog, so that sometimes you do have a concern, right, that he should not sprain his leg, or he should not get a hurt or a bruise or fall down or something, which is very valid. But then keeping him at home and absolutely not getting fresh air is not a substitute to that. So we would say that they do need some entertainment and exercise. Allow some time for that. And yes, Ali did mention to you that free air and water. That is something not to just gulp it all at the same time. Sip by sip by sip. Possibly you can have a measured water bottle for them. And instead of, you know, putting it down their throats and saying, drink water, sit down and explain to them that, hey, connected to their studies. You say, what does this water have? It has a lot of H2O, and a lot of O is needed, you know, for the functioning, energized functioning of our body. Oxygen is needed, and this has that. Take deep breaths. Don't be in a rush for everything. And juices, not your processed ones, fresh fruit juices, always helps them to feel a little energized where they have their natural sugars in it. And of course, timely food. Please ensure that the routines are maintained. It should not be so haywire that, no, ma, I have to complete this particular chapter. So Monday lunch is happening at 4 o'clock and breakfast is happening at 12, and suddenly some snacks are happening in the midnight. If all those things are avoided, it sets a good playing ground for the child to, you know, kind of plan, prepare well for his upcoming exams. So snacks also, let it not be too snacky types, something which can, you know, maintain his digestion levels also well. Moving on to, yeah, this is something we really, really need to keep in mind. Your stress affects the child. Either she gets too stressed or rebels. Going to say that it is absolutely normal if you are stressed, because you want your child and your ward to do well. You want your child to really perform well, come out with flying colors. But then that stress is yours now. If you pass it on to your child, they will also get too stressed, because we see so many children, they end up telling that, no, I don't want to fail my parents. They have given me so much. They have given me a separate room to study, and my mother makes good things for me. She ensures that the water bottle is filled, and she ensures that things are happening on time, and they start getting stressed. Not a good idea. If you are stressed, open up those stress situations with someone else so that you are also sorted. That's also very important. or they are going to rebel and say, Amma, go chill, ma, I'm not going to study. So that's both things. Let's avoid that and make them feel acknowledged, make them feel good about what they are doing. So, and of course, none of us likes to be compared. So don't compare them to give them good encouragement, positive strokes, which will actually take care of their journey, the process of studying, and not just the end results. Yes. Now, how do I help my child? This is sometimes a constant question running in the minds of parents, and we have jotted down a few points and hope it really helps you through, because exams are upcoming, so they are your exams. You seem to be studying more, and many of the answers you know better than your child, and you'll be giving, you forgot this bullet point, you forgot that bullet point, right? So we'll help you also, and you help the child. Check out his peak energy time. Make him study difficult subjects. I'm going to say that if his peak timing of, you know, studying well, child, and when you make them study the difficult subjects first, in the peak study time, their capability, ability to study difficult topics, which are maybe a little uninteresting yet difficult also, so it's a very dangerous combo, uninteresting and difficult. Make them study at that time, so it kind of sinks in better. Breaks in studies are essential, but monitor the breaks. It should not be a big, long break. And the break should also be so that he can introspect. You know, just stand in the balcony or in a fresh air area, look out of the window and just try to introspect. That should not be the time for him to be going through his mobile or saying, Ma, I will just watch that serial right now, or I will call up Rahul. So if he calls up Rahul, the break time goes for a toss. Avoid that. And moving on, allow your child to talk his or her frustrations. But then don't give any advice. So don't give any advice. They say, Ma, you know what? Why should I study physics? Yeah, I know. True. Ma, you know what? This chemistry is boring. Who the hell brought chemistry into this world? Maths is boring. Yeah, true. I agree. They don't want your advice. They just want one punching bag whom they are going to do dishum. They are going to vomit out all the words, and then they are back to say, okay, leave, Ma. I know I will go and study. Now I'll study so hard that never in my life I ever want to study. So the spirit, you know, of what they are into, no need to advise them, respond, or, you know, criticize them. Not necessary. And each person has to find his own means of stress relief. Find your style, what suits you. Each person has a disposition. Some like to listen to soothing music. Some like to listen to like hard metallic kind of, you know, metal songs. Some just prefer to, you know, sit down, read some joke books or something like that, play with the dog, or if you have a sibling, you just like to play with your siblings or do something like that. Each one has his or her own stress relief disposition. Let us identify that and then go with that, because that is what is going to be something which is very comfortable with them. Moving on to focus on goals of life. So if we can help to get our children to understand what is the bigger picture in their life. So what is the bigger ambition goal? Automatically you will find, see, they can either become a chartered accountant, cost accountant, or you're getting it. So those changes can always be done. But it's very important for us to help them to identify the bigger picture and the bigger goals in life. They may change a little later, doesn't matter, but then they at least have a thrive to move towards that bigger goal. Yeah, this is something important. If it has not been done, let's start doing it right away, that connect their academics to real life. If they don't see the connection, then obviously they are going to ask, why you have to read geography? Why you have to read this? Yesterday, I was watching this women's IPL. And then you have these people coming from all over the world, right? And they are in different teams and things like that. And if they are in a city like Bangalore, the weather is going to be reasonably comfortable, right? If they are in a city like Delhi, and if it is the hot days, it is going to be like scorching heat, baked, toasted. That is where geography comes into the picture. If you understand the weather, if you understand whether it is a humid weather, dry weather, scorching heat, automatically a person who says, I want to be a cricketer, you can impress upon that person that how a geography lesson is going to help him to understand the winds and the way things flow. So please try and take little extra efforts to ensure that your child understands that what is the valid reason to be studying any reason, any subject. We owe it to them, right? Then coming to have an exclusive place for study, distraction, sound, light. So a small thing like not having a chair where people are going to move, or keeping the table away from the aroma of the good palak paneer or paneer masala you're going to make. All these are going to help the child have a comfortable chair. Let them have a good posture of sitting. Sound is available, good light. Sound is not available, light is available. Small things, but go a long way. And moving on to, yeah, this is a damn cute thing. We call it SQ3RT. Okay. Now, these things should not be done just within 3-4 days of your exams. Okay. So, all these have to be made as a habit. But nonetheless, even if we start right now, and if they have a month or more, we can make a good headway in all these things. It's called survey. It's quite clear, I think. Survey, question, read, recite, review, test. SQ3RT. A simple method to make your learnings permanent. Mind mapping. You're studying chemistry. First of all, what are the different chapters? How do you connect it? Organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry. And then in organic chemistry, what are the different topics that come in? In that, again, put it as A, B, C. See, it may seem that it's a little laborious, but I can assure you that a little planning will actually go a long way, that when you're writing your exam, it comes out like a photograph in your mind. So SQ3RT is again something that is very much needed, which is called the mind mapping. Again, on the day of the exam, don't get into things. I find this damn cute. There are people who are going on two-wheelers and the daddy or mummy or uncle are dropping them. And this child has his head on the books and then go da 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 da. They go on. I'm sure it doesn't remain in their minds at all, right? Somebody would have called up and told, dude, did you study this da? Oh, no, I didn't. And then she goes da 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 da. So it goes on and on. I find kids going by auto and then, you know, their hair is flying and that paper is flying. Pages are flying in the notebook. They are holding it to study. Last minute, you know, doesn't work. Send them with a nice, you know, smiling face and ensure that they feel comfortable maintaining their routine of whatever that they have done and not do anything extraordinarily out of the normal routine. Okay. And these are some few basic tips. And if you think that your child has got some time and may need some help, we are absolutely happy to put them on and help them with study skills at the academy. It's totally free. With that, I sign off for a short break so that Ali can come along and answer all your questions. Ciao. Bye-bye.
actually, I wish we can spend more time in preparing the child for exams of life rather than these so-called academic exams. But that's another topic by itself. Maybe we'll talk about it some other time. So we've got a lot of hello, everyone. Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, Ali and Team Banjara. Good afternoon, all and Banjara's team. Good afternoon, Ali ji and Team Banjara. Good afternoon, Purnima. Along with that, a few things that I wanted to add on to that. Yes, Chetna has a very relevant question. If student has fear of math, how to handle? I think most children do have a fear of particular subjects, math being one of the prominent ones. See, let us understand that there are children who have left brain, mathematical and logical intelligence. And there are children who are creative, who are intuitive, who are emotional. Now, a child who is right-brained definitely does not do very well in math. But the question is, as you mentioned, why is there a fear of math? Even if the child is not going to score very high, the child is giving 5-6 subjects. If the child scores very well in some subjects, and in some subject like math, he gets low marks, as long as he is not failing in maths, his average will still work out well. And if the child is told that after you finish your basic, 10th standard, you can opt for other streams which do not require math. Now, that is where the fear comes in. Because the child thinks that science and math is the only good career option. Many children, and more than children, many parents seem to feel that science is superior to commerce and commerce is superior to arts. To some extent, it was true one generation back, but the parents are still stuck on that. We need to understand that those days are gone. Children who do not do well in math, but they pass. If you can help your child, firstly, by giving certain inputs, whereby the child can do fairly well. He may score much lesser than what he scores in other subjects. The average will come out to be good. He'll get admission and he will move on. But if he is told that you need not study math after this particular exam, his pressure is off. He feels much more relaxed. Now his only goal is to make sure that he gets some decent marks in maths. He knows that his parents are not expecting him to get 95% in math. So I will put in the effort and you help him with certain, techniques. Math is something which requires a little bit of different techniques. There are some excellent math tutors or even people who are not professional tutors, but who can give good tips on mathematics. They will help the child to score at least reasonably well. And then the child moves on for higher studies which do not involve math. Roshan says, never told my 3 children to study and get good marks. Gave them the freedom to do whatever they wanted to do. My daughter never studied and got good marks, just being free and happy. On the other hand, my 2 sons will study and study as their goal was to get a first rank. Always, my daughter was happy-go-lucky, trusting herself and her dear God to help her, whereas my sons always serious about getting good marks. Remaining happy is always better than getting good marks than remaining serious. Very true, very true. Now, as a parent, if you take off the pressure, 50% of the problem is over. If the child knows that my parent is not going to scold me if I get less marks in math or in whatever subject I'm poor in, if you encourage the child to study more and more of the subject which he likes, which he enjoys doing, automatically what happens? his average comes up and he is happy with it. The second step is to find out and tell the child what are the careers which, you know, connect to certain subjects. So if you are good in social studies, what you can do. If you are good in business studies or in accountancy, what is it that you can do? In fact, many children do not even know what those subjects are. In many schools, things like accountancy and business studies are not taught up to 10th standard. Even psychology or sociology or political science is not taught. So there's also this fear that if I don't take up science, you see, science, all the four subjects of science are taught at the 10th standard level. So every child more or less knows what is maths, what is physics, what is chemistry, and what is biology. Whereas the others are a mystery. So if the school does not provide that, it is up to us to provide. Just show a textbook of those subjects and say, you don't have to study, just browse through it and you will find something useful over here. If you feel that you are connecting with these, then we'll consider that as your optional subjects for your plus two. And then using those, what are the careers that you can take up? There are dozens and dozens of careers, both in commerce as well as in arts. Take up any one of those and you will realize that you can do extremely well. That is how we need to be, you know, helping the children. Once the child starts seeing some goals in life, something to look forward to, automatically the tension of the exam comes down. When I'm speaking to students who are of 11th and 12th standard, I give them this example. I tell them that once you finish with your 12th standard and once you become 18 years old, you would like to have a motorbike. And to get a bike, you have to have a license. And to get a license, you have to give an exam in the RTO. How many of you say, no, I've already given 10th standard exam, 12th standard exam, entrance exam, so many exams, why should I give one more exam? You don't say that, no. You look forward to it. You say, the moment I'm 18, I would like to go and give this test so that I can pass and I can get my driving license. The driving license is a passport for the child to move on to a better life so that he can have his own bike. The same way, explain to the child that any of these annual exams or board exams are meant for as passports for you to move on to a better quality of life. If that is instilled in children, they will really enjoy and they will look forward to those exams and they will do well. As Purni said, anything individually, if you have doubts or questions, you can always get back to us. If you feel that the child is not responding to whatever efforts you are making towards studies, please get through to us. We will gently talk to the child. We don't give tuitions, but we help the child to understand how to study, the methodology which can make studies easier and which can help the child to learn and to score better and to actually get involved and interested in the studies, looking forward beyond the exams. So let's all put in our efforts jointly. Whatever best we can do, let us all help the children in whatever way. Have that positive spirit. Keep encouraging every child you meet who is going through annual exams or board exams right now and help them to look forward to a better life. So with that, I will sign off. Let us enjoy the coming of the summer. Let us plan out summer vacation. That also helps if you tell the child that after the exams, we'll go for a nice summer vacation. We'll enjoy something or the other. That also gives a good spirit to the child. And keep doing that. And we shall be meeting again next Saturday, as you know, at 2 o'clock. And we'll continue this series of these talks. And next Saturday is a slightly unusual subject. I don't know how many of you have heard of this thing called kintsugi. It is a simple Japanese art of rebuilding once you have. See, they are based on when pots. If you have a pot and the pot cracks, what do? the best way to fill it up is with gold, they say. So they fill that crack with gold, and that gold shines and shows people that I have a crack which I'm not afraid of. We will discuss that. It's a wonderful technique. I have also been doing simple workshops on that to teach the art of kintsugi to people. He will be doing some workshops also at some time. But I would like you, if you're interested, to log in next Saturday at 2 o'clock, where I will talk about this very, very wonderful and time-proven technique of kintsugi, which helps you to rebuild whenever there are cracks in your life. Thank you, and bye-bye.